الله ربي والإسلام ديني ومحمدا رسول الله.
In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious and the Most Merciful. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Zayd's full name is Zayd ibn Haritha. He was born approximately 581 CE. His father's name was Harithah ibn Sharahil, and his mother was Suda bint Thaalaba. Zayd ibn Haritha was a slave who was adopted as a foster son by the Prophet Muhammad. He first met the Prophet when Zayd ibn Haritha was a slave bought by Hakim ibn Hizam, Khadijah's nephew, at the Ukkaz market. Hakim gave him as a gift to Khadijah when Zayd was 8 years old at that time. Zayd went with his mother to visit his family. While they were staying with the Maan tribe, horsemen from a rival tribe raided their tribe and kidnapped Zayd. They took him to the Ukkaz market and sold him as a slave for 400 dinars. At that time, slavery was considered a necessity due to societal needs. This was the case in Athens, Greece, Rome, and also in the Arabian Peninsula. Zayd's family searched for him, but without success. His father, Harithah ibn Sharahil, is attributed with a lament. "I weep for Zayd, not knowing what became of him. Is he alive, is he to be expected, or has death come over him? By God, I ask yet do not comprehend. Was it the plain or the mountain that brought about your end? I wish that I knew. Will you ever return? In this world, only for your coming back I yearn. The sun reminds me of him when it dawns, evoking his memory as the dusk falls. When the winds blow, they stir up memories like dust. Oh, how long my sorrow and fear for him last." Zayd was purchased by a merchant from Mecca named Hakim ibn Hizam, who gave the boy as a gift to his aunt, Khadijah bint Khuwaylid. Zayd remained in her possession until the day she married Muhammad, at which point she presented him as a wedding gift to her bridegroom. Muhammad became very attached to Zayd, referring to him as Al-Habib, the beloved. The Prophet gladly accepted Zayd and immediately freed him. His generous and loving heart was poured out for Zayd, and he was raised with the same tenderness and love as if he were his own son. Zayd ibn Haritha felt very sad when he first lived with Khadijah. He longed for the affection of his mother and the gentleness of his father. Zayd couldn't stop thinking about them. He felt his life was shattered and painful because he was separated from his parents, exiled, and made into a slave. However, this was the home that Allah chose for Zayd. The longer he stayed there, the more comfortable he felt in that home, and slowly he began to love his new family. He loved his parents, who gave him love like a mother's love. Zayd ibn Haritha was a man with extraordinary or different abilities from others, and this ability was evident since Zayd was a child. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam worshipped for several nights in a cave in Hira, Khadijah provided food and drink for the Prophet and even accompanied him to the foot of the hill. Khadijah kept watching her husband climb the hill until he disappeared from her sight. Zayd ibn Haritha, who witnessed the event, was greatly impressed. Until one sunny day, the first call of revelation came to the Prophet Muhammad, which was when he received the first revelation. "Read, O Prophet, in the name of your Lord who created humans from a clinging clot. Read, and your Lord is the most generous, who taught by the pen, taught humanity what they knew not." Quran, Surah Al-Alaq, verses 1-5. Immediately after the Prophet Muhammad undertook his prophetic mission with the descent of the first revelation, Zayd ibn Haritha became the first slave to embrace Islam and immediately believed in the Prophet. There was an incident where Khadijah met Waraka ibn Nawfal at a certain time, during which Waraka informed Khadijah about the previous and final prophets who would be sent by Allah to the people of Mecca and to all mankind until the Day of Judgment. Zayd ibn Haritha listened attentively to what he heard. It is not surprising that he embraced Islam immediately after being preached by the Prophet Muhammad, without any further delay. The Prophet Muhammad had great affection for Zayd. The love of the Prophet was fitting and deserving, considering Zayd's unparalleled honesty, noble spirit, gentleness, and purity of heart. All of this adorned Zayd ibn Haritha, or beloved Zayd, as he was affectionately called by the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Zayd ibn Haritha had three children with different wives. Among Zayd's wives often mentioned in the story, he was married to Zainab bint Yash, because in this story, Zayd's name is clearly mentioned in the Quran. Allah ordained the niece of the Prophet to marry Zayd ibn Haritha. The Prophet Muhammad then married Zayd ibn Haritha to his niece, Umayma bint Abdul Muttalib, whose name was Zainab. Zainab's full name was Zainab bint Yash ibn Riyab, and her mother's name was Umayma bint Abdul Muttalib ibn Hashim. Their individual marriage surprised Mecca because it was considered unlikely for a former slave like Zayd to marry a noblewoman like Zainab. Initially, Zainab's brother, Abdullah ibn Yash, did not approve of a noblewoman marrying a former slave, even if he was born to Arab parents. Due to the many disputes from various factions, there was a revelation in the Quran that explained this. It is not for a believing man or woman when Allah and His Messenger decree a matter to have any other choice in that matter. Indeed, whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger has clearly gone far astray. Quran, Surah Al-Azab, verse 36. So Zainab bint Yash married Zayd ibn Haritha to fulfill the command of Allah and the command of the Prophet, while also following the teachings of Islam that do not differentiate people except based on their piety towards Allah. However, their married life was not smooth. Zainab could not forget her status as a noblewoman, and this caused Zayd to be greatly distressed by Zainab's rejection. This condition then forced Zayd ibn Haritha to complain to the Prophet Muhammad repeatedly about Zainab's behavior towards him. At that time, the Prophet Muhammad instructed Zayd to be patient and to fear Allah, saying, "Keep your wife and fear Allah." However, on the other hand, the Prophet was also concerned about how to resolve this issue. Until finally, the gap between Zayd ibn Haritha and Zainab bint Yash widened further until it reached a deadlock. Due to the unavoidable option of divorce, Allah allowed Zayd to divorce his wife and commanded the Prophet to marry Zainab. When the Prophet married Zainab, he did not require a guardian or witnesses because Allah himself performed the marriage. This story is explained in the Quran, Surah Al-Azab, verse 37. And, remember, O Prophet, when you said to the one for whom Allah has done a favor and you, too, have done a favor, keep your wife and fear Allah, while concealing within yourself what Allah was going to reveal. And, so, you were considering the people, whereas Allah was more worthy of your consideration. So when Zayd totally lost interest in keeping his wife, we gave her to you in marriage, so that there would be no blame on the believers for marrying the ex-wives of their adopted sons after their divorce. And Allah's command is totally binding. Quran, Surah Al-Azab, verse 37. Due to this incident, there was uproar among the slanderers and enemies of the Prophet. They criticized why the Prophet married his adopted son's former wife. Allah later answered these challenges and criticisms with His revelation, distinguishing between adopted and biological children and nullifying the long-standing customs among the pre-Islamic Arabs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, "Muhammad is not the father of any of your men, but is the messenger of Allah and the seal of the prophets. And Allah has perfect knowledge of all things." Quran, Surah Al-Azab, verse 40. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, "There is no blame on the Prophet for doing what Allah has ordained for him. That has been the way of Allah with those, prophets, who had gone before. And Allah's command has been firmly decreed. Quran, Surah Al-Azab, verse 38. Allah willed to abolish the prevailing custom of having numerous adopted children. The correct way was to marry them to the former wives of their adopted sons, and this experience directly affected the Islamic religious leaders to make their hearts more accepting. Zayd ibn Haritha was one of the famous archers among the Prophet's companions. He fought at Uhud, the Trench, and Khaybar, and was present at the expedition to Hudaybiyah. When Muhammad raided Al-Muraisi, he left Zayd behind as the governor in Medina. Zayd commanded 7 military expeditions. The Muslim troops marched to Al-Qurada, Al-Jumam, Al-Iz, At-Taraf, Hizma, Wadi Al-Qura, and the Battle of Mutah. Zayd ibn Haritha was the commander in all those battles. As Aisha radhiyallahu anha said, the Messenger of Allah never sent Zayd ibn Haritha in an army without putting him in command of it. Finally, the Battle of Mutah took place. It seemed that the Romans and their declining empire were filled with apprehension and foreboding about the rapid spread of Islam. They saw it as a genuine and fatal threat to their very existence, especially in Syria, which bordered the center of the sweeping new religion. Therefore, they used Syria as a springboard to the Arab Peninsula and the Muslim nation. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam realized that the aim of the Roman skirmishes was to test the combat readiness of the Muslims. Therefore, he decided to take the initiative and demonstrate in action Islam's determination to resist and achieve ultimate victory. In September 629 CE, the Muslim army marched towards Al-Balqa in Syria until they reached its borders, where the armies of the Romans and Arabicized tribes residing at the borders were stationed. The Roman army pitched camp at a place called Masha Arif, while the Muslim army pitched camp near a town called Mutah. Hence, the battle was named Mutah. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam knew how important and crucial this battle was. Therefore, he chose 3 commanders who were worshippers by night and fighters by day. These 3 fighters dedicated their lives and property to Allah and renounced their needs and desires for the sake of great martyrdom, which would pave their way to win Allah's pleasure and to see Allah, the Generous. The 3 commanders were, in succession, Zayd ibn Haritha, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, and Abdullah ibn Rawaha, radhiyallahu anhum. Thus, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam bid farewell to his army and gave them his order, saying, Zayd ibn Haritha is your first commander, but in case he is wounded, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib will take over the command, and if he is also wounded, Abdullah ibn Rawaha will take over. Although Ja'far ibn Abi Talib was one of the Prophet's closest friends, known for his valor, fearlessness, and noble lineage, the Prophet chose him as the second commander after Zayd. Thus, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam emphasized the fact that the new religion of Islam came to abolish corrupt human relationships based on false and superficial discrimination, establishing new rational human relationships instead. It was as if the Prophet foresaw the events of the imminent battle, as he assigned the command of the army to Zayd, Ja'far, and then Abdullah. Strangely enough, all of them were raised to Allah in the same order set by him. When the Muslims saw the vanguard of the Roman army, estimated to consist of 200,000 warriors, they were stunned by its enormity, surpassing all expectations. But since when did the battles of faith depend on numbers? At that moment, the Muslims flung themselves into the battlefield, regardless of the consequences or jeopardy. Their commander, Zayd, carried the Prophet's standard and fought his way through the enemy's spears, arrows, and swords. He was not so much seeking victory as concluding his deal with Allah, who had purchased the lives and properties of Muslims in exchange for paradise. Zayd saw neither the sand of Balqa nor the Roman forces. The only things he saw were the hills of paradise and its green cushions. These images flickered through his mind like the fluttering flags that had announced his wedding day. When he thrust and struck, he not only struck at the necks of his enemies, but also flung the doors open that stood in his way to the vast door through which he would reach the home of peace, the eternal paradise, and the company of Allah. Zayd clung to his destiny. His spirit, on its way up to heaven, was overjoyed as it took its last glance at the body of its master, which was not covered with soft silk, but rather with pure blood shed in the way of Allah. His serene smile widened when he saw the second commander, Ja'far, dart towards the standard and hold it high before it touched the ground. After Zayd, Ja'far, and Abdullah, radhiyallahu anhum, became martyrs, Khalid ibn al-Walid took command. At a later time, Prophet Muhammad bestowed upon Khalid the title of Saifullah, meaning Sword of Allah. Today, Muslims who fell in the battle are considered martyrs, Shahada. A mausoleum was later built at Muta over their graves. The mausoleum of Zayd ibn Haritha, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, and Abdullah ibn Rawaha took place in Al-Mazar near Muta, Jordan. Wallahu alam bisawab. Hopefully, this is all useful. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.